We are honoured and pleased to introduce Cornelia Parker, one of Britain's best loved and most acclaimed artists, known for her inventive, provocative and destructive works. Parker demonstrates the importance of protest. Working in an incredibly wide variety of mediums, be that snake venom, chalk or cocaine, her works ask the most prevalent questions of society. Having just completed a retrospective at Tate Britain, which I'm sure many of you attended, Parker has shown all around the world, and tonight she's with us here in Oxford. So please join me in welcoming Cornelia to the stage.
Thank you to the Society for inviting me. Can you hear me properly? Yes, it's good. I'm about 6 mics here, all sort of reverberating. Okay, I'm just going to whiz through a few slides for about 45 minutes, and after we can stop and have a long take. It might be a little sooner or a bit later. And then, just out of interest, how many of you saw my show in London? So some of these names will be familiar. Could I have the lights down? It's really very bright. A bit more dark. I like doing presentations in the dark. That's all right, that's good. I'm going to start off with a very familiar piece. This is called Focus to Silver, which was made in 1988, end of 88, and I had a steamroller run over all this silver plate, and I wanted to kill it off symbolically, and then I resurrected it by suspending it just above the floor to give back the volume that I'd robbed with the objects. The reason I wanted to run over the silver steamroller was that we all have a bit of silver, and nobody wants to have it out. It's in the cupboard, it tarnishes, it's usually made of base metal, it's usually not real silver. And for some reason, I really liked it, and still like it as a material. Luckily, the Tate bought this piece many years ago, so one good thing about the Tate buying it, because it worked rather than a private collector, is it doesn't end up at an auction down the road, and it gets looked after. So all these objects which have got fractured by the steamroller all got their own little tray, in a kind of chest of drawers at the table. It's amazing. The same little drawings I'd done, very rushed in the middle of the night. I worked all night to get the piece up in the first place. It was shown at the Icon Gallery. So this idea of killing things off and resurrecting it is something that I've worked over the years, mostly with large scale works. So this is my cold dark matter and exploded view, which is a garden shed in contents that's been blown up for me by the British Army, 1991. I like working with people that are not from the art world. It's much more interesting. And collaborating with the Army was really interesting. And at the time, I was much criticised for it because, there's this whole thing about who you can't use as a sponsor. And I felt the sponsor, or the person who's helping you, is very much part of the work. And so I like this ambivalent stance. This was the time of IRA bombs in London, terrorist bombs, which were, it affected London quite badly. So we always live with that kind of threat of the bomb. My book saying The Artist Dilemma, which is one of the things that was blown up in the shed. And all the stuff in the shed was taken from various friends' sheds or from car boot sales. A car boot sale, but people sell stuff from their sheds, that's all they sell, really. So I sort of bought all kinds of bags of curlers, all kinds of objects, books. But it's basically like an overstore for my house. This was in a few years later, and this piece is called Cold Dark Matter. Cold and Dark Matter, Mass. It was really called Mass. And it was a church struck by lightning in Texas. I was doing a residency in Texas, and I was trying to find things struck by lightning. And in lightning quick. And only a few days after I put out an alert to firemen and all kinds of people about a lightning strike, I got this phone call saying, hey, this church just got being struck by lightning. So I drove 15 miles down to the town where this church had been razed to the ground. And there's some different piece called Anti-Mass. The first one was called Mass, this is Anti-Mass. This was made a few years later. The first church was a white congregation church, Baptist church, struck by lightning. The other church is an arsoned black congregation church. So both burnt churches, both, you know. But this still goes on in Texas. You know, there's some states in America that you know, churches are arsoned, but had like a hate crime. And I thought it was quite interesting about where those two pieces ended up. You know, this one ended up in a museum in San Francisco, and the earlier piece was bought by Phoenix Art Museum, but they didn't want to buy the other piece. They didn't want they didn't want the mass and anti-mass. They didn't want the political end. You know, the two together would have been great for them to both join to the same home. But I did manage to show them once in San Francisco, at the Yoga Center, the Yoga Buena Center. And so it was great to have two. So the dimensions are the same, the materials are, you know, slightly different, but one's an act of God and one's an act of man. This is called Edge of England, and it's chalk from Beachy Head. It's a large quantity of chalk. This is pieces about, I don't know how many metres, 20 feet. And so it's like a giant cinema screen, so it's like a hung cliff. So I made this piece, and it's putting back a cliff, it's putting back a suicide spot, because Beachy Head is one of the most popular suicide spots in the world. And it now hangs in a museum in Milwaukee, and they bought it many years ago, it's 1999. They bought it many years ago, and they've shown it ever since. They've never taken it off display, which I think is brilliant. I met all these people from Milwaukee the other day when they came to Freeze Art Fair, and they were all telling me how this is one of the only works that's not been taken down. And then they exchanged the wires. You know, they started one end and changed the wires all the way through it just to keep it maintained. So I was very pleased about that. And I like the fact that, you know, the Edge of England is hanging in Milwaukee. I did make it first for a Biennale in Australia, and that's the first time I, you know, put it up. And they said this was a post-colonial statement, you know, this me moving the Edge of England, you know, down to Australia was, you know, that. This is the lifting mechanism of Tower Bridge. The green cylinder is a hydraulic pump in a way, and it goes up and down with the bridge, and it weighs about 20 tons. And I was asked to do a piece of work for the British Galleries at the V&A, and I wanted to use a famous monument to squash my brass band. So I like the idea of a British institution being squashed by another one. and at one point I thought I'd quite like to have it, you know, where the things came together, and of course that was very practical. So, but they very happily made a jig for me, the guys there, and so we, you know, so kept opening and closing and squashing the objects. And the piece was called Breathless. So it's a brass band that's inhaled but not exhaled, and it's tarnished black on the underside, so it's like a ceiling rose. And on above, it's polished silver. I made it when I was pregnant with Lily. I was 9 months pregnant when I made that, 21 years ago. And then a few years later, I made another brass band piece. This time it wasn't flat, it was sitting upright. And this one was called Perpetual Canon, which is a musical term. It's like a round. And this sousaphone, which is this really big instrument here, is the biggest thing I've ever squashed. I gave I give up on steamrollers. I'm much more interested now in 250-ton presses. These old welding factories, sure, they've gone under actually, one by one, the places I used and no longer exist. Have to use Imperial College now, because they have some very fancy sort of pressing device. But the sousaphone, which is a marching band instrument, we had to get a forklift truck to press it down the forklift truck till it got to a certain flatness. You know, there was a couple of boards outside of it, and then we could fit it into this 250-ton press. So very technical. But I like the shadows there. Shadows I've used a lot in my work. It's I like the fact you can the viewers are between the piece and the shadows, so they're kind of participants in the work. Our dear Queen. This is Poppy Day, in remembrance of Sunday. And I went to visit the poppy factory. I was going to make a piece for the war, 1418 war celebrations. And so I went to the factory in Richmond and I saw poppies being made. And they have this machine which punches out the poppies. It punches out the pieces of paper which get crimped and made into poppies. And I asked what happens to the paper with the holes in it. And they said that they just throw it away. So I asked them if I could have enough to make this work, which I made this, which is my room called War Room, and it's like a diptych to the Exploded Shed. When I showed it first in Manchester at the Whitworth in 2015, sorry. And so there's about 400,000 holes in this room, and it's got a moiré to it because there's two layers, like a double negative. So people start to feel a bit queasy when they're in there. So this is the red room, this tent that I made was based on, you can't tell you, it was based on this. This is the Field of the Cloth of Gold, which is Henry VIII's tent that he put up in France so that he and the French king could have a peace summit, which didn't go anywhere. They were at war again within a year. And so it was a very fancy tent, so this is kind of one of the things I was looking at. This is not by me, sadly, I wish it was. This is by Marcel Duchamp, and it's a mile of string, which he draped all over an exhibition of surrealist art in New York in 1942. All the other poor artists didn't get their work looked at because he tried to basically sabotage everything. He didn't even turn up to the opening. He sent some kids in to play football in there, so just to add more mayhem to the whole thing. This is from the Tate Triennale in 2003, I think it is. This is called The Distance, and then in brackets, The Kiss with String Attached. So basically, it's Rodin's The Kiss with a mile of string attached to it. So my intervention with just one artwork rather than loads of artworks. And I always thought that this was a very, the story of these lovers is very tragic. They got killed by the jealous husband because they were having an affair. And they were part of the gates of hell, Dante's gates of hell. And really, I always thought the kiss, this version of the kiss was bought by these two guys who lived down in Brighton. And it wasn't lewd enough for them. They wanted something, bigger genitals, something like that. There was some reason why they didn't like it. Anyway, it was put on a show for the public in the public library, British public thought it was too lewd, so they had to cover it up. So it was covered over for 2 years. I really like all this sort of kind of history about it. So the string was my little intervention. I felt it made a complication in the work, a temporary interruption in the work. And then somebody, a a stockist surrounded by a lot of other stockists. You know, stockists, they're a group that are very pro art pre-1900, and don't like anything contemporary at all. And they thought I was vandalising the program, so they had this kind of seminar around it, and one of them got some scissors out and chopped all the string off. And I thought, what would Duchamp do at this point? So I decided that Duchamp would tie it all back in together again and put it back on it, so that's what I did. And then I kept, later when the piece came down, I kept the string. So there's the minor string here with all the knots from the stockist cuts, and it contains a weapon. And unless you x-ray, you would never know what the weapon is. It's called the distance, and then in brackets, with concealed weapon. this is a map in the underground at Westminster, and I photograph it quite often. I've got little photographs. This particular photograph, it's tourist fingers have distressed the map because people are pointing at, you know, Westminster. So they should. So they should. Especially now. Anyway, so this damage done by fingers, but then 2 days later after this, there was that horrible terrorist attack in Westminster where the police officer got killed. So it's a really weird time. I was going to Westminster because I was asking the House of Commons, not the House of Commons, but the Palace of Westminster, if I could have material that they were refurbishing it. And so I was very eager to have whatever they were throwing away. and then there was a snap election, and they said, oh, do you want to be a lecture artist? So I suddenly became a lecture artist, which was for the Theresa May, one where she got a hung parliament, very appropriate, I thought. I said, yes, I would be the lecture artist, which was very brave of me, I thought. And then they told me I couldn't be biased anywhere. I couldn't give away my politics, you know, say whether I was left or right or whatever. I thought, oh no. And then I thought, oh, how great. This is really good. I'm going to do, yes, this makes it much easier. So actually, it informed all the work I made. So I made sure I started Instagram, which I'd never done before. I'd never done any social media before, but I had to do it. They told me I had to do it, so I did it. And then, so if I took a photograph of something leaning right, then I have to have something leaning left. So a cat leaning right, you know, bush leaning right. So I just became obsessed with all and things that were red, blue, and yellow. I was photographing all those. So I just got more and more crazy. And in the end, I made a film. I made two films for them. One was called Left, Right, and Centre, which was made in the House of Commons at night as a drone. The trouble is my films, I make a lot of films, but I don't usually show them in slideshows because it does take too long to. I'm trying to get them on YouTube so everyone can see them. But anyway, the one with the Instagram became a kind of animation, 3-minute animation. It's called Election Abstract, and it was just rushing through Brexit and everything. It was just all the stuff that happened during the period of time I was here working on it. This is me with the budget box. I think I did this before I was a lecture artist, definitely. This was me getting my hands on the budget, but a very old Gladstone's bag was used by the chancellors at that time, Gordon Brown, I think, you know. And then I think Lord Osborne had a replica made with fake distressing on it. And that's what the back of the budget box is. It's meant to sit on a table flat, you know, and have a handle in the middle. So Gladstone decided to put a handle on the side. And so now all the budget boxes still have a black back. It's really interesting. But that's why they go like that. So that gesture's come out of the fact that it's, you know, nobody wants, you don't want people to show things in the black, you want to show things in the red. This is quite fun. Well, it can be some show. This is a piece that's also in the Tate within the picture, but you might not have seen it because it's in the Turner galleries, and it's called Room for Margins, and it's the backs of Turner paintings, which I managed to procure from the conservation department a few years before I like them very much because they look like Rothko's. They're really beautiful. So in Turner's day, you would double stretch a canvas. You know, there'd be two layers of canvas, and you know that was a very good surface to paint on. And anyway, this is not a portrait. I put them as portraits when I display them, and they've all got this stain on the bottom. And the stain is from the 1917 flood of the Tate got flooded, and so all of them have got this tide mark at the bottom, which I really like. So it's like a Rothko room. So what's lovely about the Tate, they made the little room for me, and it's next to the Rothko room, and it's next to the Turner's, so it's really nice. And these have all got the same title as the paintings they come from, like Rough Seaweed Wreckage or Venice at Sunset or whatever. So, but they're complete abstractions. They've got the patina from having their backs to the wall for the last 150 years. Jeff, my husband, said he should call it Turner Over. this is Mia Farrow in Rosemary's Baby. And I was doing a show in Turin, and at the Museum of Turin, and I wanted to find a diptych for the Turin Shroud. And this nightgown is here. I didn't buy it. she put it in a UNICEF auction, Sotheby's auction in New York. I was very pregnant at the time, feeling very emotionally challenged, and realised the film. I went to see the film again, and I kind of thought, this could all be in her head. You know, this is, you know, the story is that she gives birth to the devil. So I'm sort of making a kind of, that I called it Blue Shift. It's behind glass, so it, as you walk by it, it has this holographic effect of moving. So looking, finding a child from the devil, even more distress. Anyway, and that's the gown. Now lives in New York. This is Oliver from Oliver Twist, and he shared. It's called Oliver Shared Fate Oliver, and it's Oliver cut in half with the guillotine that chopped off Marinette's head, which is in the Madame Tussauds Chamber of Horrors in London. She was there at the French Revolution. She took death masks off Marie Antoinette and all the people who died there. And she brought all these relics over, including the guillotine, to London. So I like the fact that Oliver's got this green on his face, which comes from the Dickens fictional story, Fagin tweaking his ear, I think. And yet he's been now given the same fate, real fate, a historical fate. And I quite like that. The old thing about fiction and fact and physicality. And I wanted to test whether the guillotine is still sharp. You know, so I got to run my finger along the edge of the guillotine, and not many people get to do that. That's what I call a sculptural moment. So lots of my work's about me just getting your hands on stuff. These are some of my poison and antidote drawings made with snake venom and black ink. And anti-venom, which is the antidote, and white ink. So this was made in from snake venom from a snake farm in Texas, and the anti-venom was very hard to get hold of. I had to get a friend's brother, who's a doctor, to prescribe me. Embryo firearms, which this is one of my favorite things of my works. This is. I did a collaboration with the factory that made Colt 45 guns and machine guns. They're all National Rifle Association card-carrying Republicans. And there's me, you know, this artist, asking them if they could shoot things through guns that weren't bullets. So they shot a pearl necklace through a shotgun into a suit, and they shot some money into a dress. So this diptych is almost like it's covered in four now, badly. inspiration for that particular piece came from Duchess of Malfi, which is a Marlowe play, Jacobean tragedy, and in it she says, "Are you going to strangle me with diamonds or shoot me with pearls?" And so that's where I got my inspiration from. So I get my inspiration from almost anywhere. And this is Sawn Up, Sawn Off Shotgun. This is a quite recent piece. This is British criminals, not American, because they have such a small board of guns to choose from, but the British ones, just they get a shotgun, they saw it off to make it more lethal, so it becomes a really dangerous weapon. So the police in Manchester, where I was working, I asked them if they'd got any confiscated guns, and they said, "Oh yes, nice sawn-off shotgun." And then they said, we have to decommission it for you before you can have it. And I said, okay. And then they got this angle grinder out and chopped it into bits. And I was quite, I was kind of taken aback, really. But I really loved, A, the action. This is these are cuts made by policemen and a cut made by a criminal. So I called it Sawn Up, Sawn Off Shotgun, and just displayed the bits. And that's another, you might think I'm a bit obsessed with guns. I'm not sure why, but they symbolise violence, I suppose. But this is a gun that's been made into rust by engineers in Manchester, and they took this, again, another gun from the police, something that's been in a violent crime, and they rusted it down with chemicals and gave me a bag, and on the bag it said precipitated gun. And I thought, wow, that's great, so I called it precipitated gun. And I had a conversation at the opening with this man who I thought was the engineer who rusted it down, but he wasn't, he was a policeman. And I said, don't you think it's like a line of cocaine? And that is a drawing made with a bullet. So I've been making bullet drawings, which is what I've had. Bullets that are being shot, melted down, made into wire, various thicknesses, and then I've made a drawing or a net or whatever with about the approximate amount you'd have in a bullet. So so this one is one of my net ones. This is Andrew's, obviously my Gainsborough. Very enigmatic painting, I really love this. I love the unfinished hands, the fact we don't know what the hands were supposed to be doing, whether they were going to hold a baby, and the baby didn't materialize, or knitting, or whatever. And I was invited to make a piece of work in Scotland for a sculpture park, and ex-student of mine, it was her and her husband's sculpture park, it's called Jupiter on Hand, and it was on the Museum of the Year a few years ago. But anyway, it's a really brilliant, beautiful place, and this landscape in this painting looks very like that. And these two reminded me a lot of Mr. and Mrs. Wilson, people who know the land. And so what I did was I got Robert's gun, and I scaled it up to 9 metres tall, and then it nestled in this tree. And I was going to call it Mr. and Mrs. Wilson. So the tree was Mrs. Wilson, and the gun was Mr. Wilson. But in the end, I decided that might be too risque, so I called it Landscape with Gun and Tree. I quite like the idea of doing something in a sculpture park that's not really sweet. I think it's really easy to sadly, when you work in nature, to make something lyrical or make something that's too poetic or whatever. So I wanted people to come across this and be really scared and wonder, where the person who owned this gun was. this is in my cracks in a path in London Fields where William Blake is buried. It's called Black Path, and I cast the cracks and made it into a bronze. So it's the worm's eye view of this path that me and my daughter used to walk along when we went to school. She used to do hopscotch through this. And people at the opening of my show were doing hopscotch through it as well. Not the tape, but in Manchester. Palestinian part of Jerusalem, late at night, I'm busy trying to cast the cracks in the pavement in the street, pavement in Jerusalem. So what I'd do, in my luggage, I'd got some extra weight in my luggage, and I got this liquid, which is cold cure rubber, and you mix the two, you mix two things together, and it, you know, takes an hour for it to go to set, so you can actually pour it into the cracks. And once it's dry, you can roll it up and put it in your suitcase. And then I cast it in England, and I showed it in Manchester, and I like this idea of William Blake, you know, Jerusalem, building Jerusalem on British soil, in England's green and pleasant land, which I've used quite recently in a film. So this is called Jerusalem. And this is the two pieces. While I was in Manchester, my terrible hair, can't you? Sorry. the henna years, the old god years. Anyway, now this is Kostyanov himself, who's a Russian physicist who won the Nobel Prize, along with Andre Geim, because they discovered graphene, which is a one atom thick layer of graphite, which once it becomes one atom thick, a 2D material, all its properties change. It's a superconductor, it's the strongest material in the world, it's been used in electronics in all kinds of ways. And I was really excited about it because I loved graphite for a start, and he was very, you know, he knew my work, he was into art himself, so we had a lot. So I said to him, can you make graphene off an old master drawing? And he said, oh, and his, you know, his face lit up, you know, his face shined. Oh yes, I have to do that, because I had access to all these old master drawings through the Whitworth, which had a collection, and the conservator helped him, you know, he got his microscope apparently, and he would see stray flakes of graphite, and he could pick them out, and then he could do his magic on them, making his graphene. And then I said, what can we do with that? Can it be a switch, you know, has it got electrical properties? And he said, yes. I said, what would trigger it? And he said, oh, a breath would do it. These are the samples. Blake, Rutherford, Constable and Turner. Rutherford, the guy who split the atom in Manchester. Everybody thinks the atom is split in Chicago. And this is Castillon, who cost him the night of my opening. And he's breathing on a piece of William Blake graphene. And beside him are these firework makers who he worked, you know, we got them together. And then we had this big firework display, which was a Blakeian abstract. So I've done quite a lot of firework displays with meteorites in them. You know, so a little piece of lunar meteorite, I call it a moon landing, so it's land. And, you know, up in the sculpture park, I did this where you know, there's a sign saying, like a National Trust sign saying, you know, a moon landed on Jupiter. And all these people, all these kids were looking for the moon. You know, they were picking up big rocks and they didn't think this was the moon. I said it had been lost. You know, so it's quite nice, that whole thing. A temporary sculpture I made in St. Pancras Station. I made a black clock identical to the white clock. And it was called One More Time. And I got the same clock makers who made the first clock, who made Big Ben, actually. And they did that one. So that was. And as people got off the train from France, the black clock would eclipse the white clock. So I used to be into really old encyclopedias, but now I'm totally into Wikipedia, as most people are. My daughter spends most of her time on Wikipedia, I think. She's a student. But I was commissioned by Oxford University and Ruskin and the British Library to make a piece of work in response to the 800th anniversary of the Magna Carta. And I was, you know, thinking, can I do something that's going to even touch the science on this, you know? And then I was looking online, and I thought, this is it, this is, you know, everything's there about the Magna Carta is on this Wikipedia page. if I could get it off the computer and if I can make it into a physical object, that would be really exciting. So I devised this idea of making it into an embroidery, hand embroidery. And it was going to be embroidered by all kinds of people, mostly prisoners who are part of a charity called Fight Cell that work with prisoners, and they teach them how to embroider. And then they get paid for their time. So a lot of, I paid everybody for their time. And this is at the British Library, what it looked like. It was 14 metres long by 1.5 metres across, and it was made in 80 strips. And then it was all put together in the Royal College of Needlework, which is at Hampton Court. They embroidered some bits. But what I did love is, when you blow something up on a computer, you get this. This is a Magna Carta, an abstraction. Then you get the back of it like that. And what I did in the Tate show, the back of the art pieces in there, but we had mirrors underneath so you could see all the back of the work, because I like the backs as well. There's a Wikipedia, done by Handel Bock, who's a military embroiderer, and that's the back. They embroidered their logo in the corner of this, and I said, you can't do that, this is Wikipedia, you don't do ads. So they unbid it. All the images are done by the Embroiderers Guild, ladies all over Britain. This one took 450 hours to make. And this is obviously from the internet, but that has got gold in it, and there's a medieval technique. So I think they quite like the whole idea that this was the back and front of John of England's signs Magna Carta. And then I got all these other people to embroider as well, so there were specialist words that I gave to particular people. So that's Jimmy Wales, who invented Wikipedia. He got to do user's manual. Baroness Doreen Lawrence, and she did a beautiful one. She did, user's manual, that's done by Jimmy Wales. Justice, Denial and Delay was done by Doreen Lawrence, who's absolutely lost her son to racist thugs, and it took her a long, long time to get justice for it. Head of the was head of the Royal Academy, doing the word folio, Christopher LeBron. This is one of the volunteer prisoners. Freedom, that was done by Julian Assange. I went to see him in the Ecuadorian embassy, and he was very neat, I thought. Free Man, that was done, Paddy Hill, one of the Birmingham Six, and he went to what's the wonderful woman, the lawyer who got him out?
Gareth Pierce,
yeah. I went to Gareth's house. And I met him, and I said, oh, that is a bit clunky. And he said, I did it twice. It's a protest E. Common People, Jarvis Cocker. A Contemporary Political Relevance was done by Alan Rusbridger, who used to be a master here in Oxford, and that's a bit of his blood. He pricked his finger, I just thought it was so. And he sent me this text saying, there is blood. I said, great, it's good. Blood of an editor. Liberty was done by Edward Snowden in Moscow. And this is a lovely note he sent me and Caroline, my project manager. Did it. This was completed on a snowy day during my unexpected Moscow exile. Thank you for your generous patience and understanding. I do apologise for the mistakes. It is the first needlework I've completed, and it required much learning. With my very best regard to you, your country, and your craft, which I thought was pretty great. Okay, we are on the next last leg now. This spot is on top of the Metropolitan Museum in New York. It's the best spot ever given to an artist to make a piece of work for, I think, because it's just this beautiful blank canvas. Surrounded by this wonderful landscape, and then there's Central Park just behind. And for some reason, I kept thinking about red barns. I felt that at some point, when it was New Amsterdam, it might be covered in red barns, Dutch red barns. And, you know, it just seemed to stick in my head that that's what I should do. This is Hopper, Edward Hopper's red barns. This is Banner with red barns by Hopper. Politicians love red barns because they symbolise, goodness. That's why you find all kinds of people outside Red Barn. Anyway, I discovered that Red Barns in America were absolutely massive. There was no way I could get one of them onto the roof of the net. Because I had all these ideas to do barn storming and barn dancing and all kinds of stuff. Having it built by shakers or whatever. And then all that went out the window. And then when I was looking at Hopper, this is a house by the railroad, a very famous Hopper painting. And this is this is Hitchcock's Psycho House, and the two things, Hitchcock used the Hopper as the model for his, one's a famous painting, the other one's this two sides, the set is like this. This is the back of the Psycho House. So I decided I was going to make the Psycho House set out of a red barn. So I could merge these two ideas, the good and the evil. So I found a red barn, and I got the wood from it. And then it was taken to the set builders, who did all the sets for all the political debates, Clinton and Trump debates on TV. So it's really pertinent. They were called Showman. And then I put my version. It's called Transitional Object Psycho Barn. So this is my psycho barn. And all the shingles are made out of the corrugated metal of the roof of the barn. And then when you get around the back, you've got that. And I was really worried because I knew in the film it was on top of a hill. And I was thinking, how can I get a hill in here? And then when I went in Central Park and I looked up, I realized the net was the hill. So I was really, really thrilled with the view of it from there. And I kept getting photographs sent to me from all over the world. And this, somebody sent me this. It's a helicopter shot. I mean, I haven't actually done that. And then a piece came to London. It was shown in the courtyard of the Royal Academy. This is not mine. This is Fox Talbot, famous photographer from the 1840s, one of the pioneers of photography. He invented the photogravure and also the photographic negative. And I'm a very big fan of his work. This is not mine, it's by me. What I did was take, I was commissioned by Trinity Hall in Cambridge to make a tapestry. And a tapestry that went missing. I was going to make this tapestry. So what I did was take 30 pieces of silver from their silver collection, and I melted one down. You see the shadow is no object? So it was called 30 pieces of silver minus one. And then I had wire, it made into wire, and then I had it woven into the tapestry when it's been made. So it's still got the object in the tapestry, but you can't see it. And this is us, the opening. This is in the dining room. What I like about this place is it's Trinity Hall. Trinity's next door. Trinity is where Fox Talbot studied, and he very often would eat in this, this room. This is another Fox Talbot. This is a really famous photograph. It's called Articles of Glass, I think 1844. I showed my Magna Carta here at the Bodleian Library, and I heard that they had bought the last remaining pieces of glassware from this image. So I took so those are the only bits that are left. I've taken away the rest digitally. And so I asked them if I could borrow them to make some prints. So this is one of the prints. This is the objects you saw in that image, the Fox Talbot's Articles of Glass. And this is their basis. This is me putting them onto a photographic plate and making them into a print. It's called Bottoms Up. And that's that's the, those are the objects, the only objects left. The reason they're so dark is because the glass has got a lead in it, so that makes it register as a, and this is, I decided to make the compositions I made a little bit more lively. Okay, last couple of slides and then we'll talk. So these are some neon pieces I made last year. Very soft, reality delusion, that says. Black and white. And that's it.
Thank you, Mrs. Parker. That was really interesting. And I was reading your biography yesterday, and I realised that you've been to art academies, and I'm just wondering, what do you think is the most valuable thing that going to an institution to receive art education has given you? And do you think that is like an indispensable part for your career or for any artist's career? Do you think arts can...
I was very lucky because I went at a time when we all got free educations. The work I've made since I've left college is like by far better, much better work. So I think, and as, when I started working at home rather than the studio, a designated art space, all of a sudden it got much more interesting. So I'm perhaps not, I'm me, but somebody else might be different. But I think sometimes, like at the Royal Academy at the moment, for example, because I'm a Royal Academician, but the students there get 3 years MA paid for, it's free. And I think that's brilliant, but I think 3 years is too long. I thought 2 years might be good, and you'd have more students go through. I don't know. I think sometimes making stuff in the real world, because you've got all kinds of factors playing into that, like money, how space. I mean, I made all this work in a house, which was a squat. And I made all this stuff on the ceiling because there was people living in the house and the ceiling wasn't being used. And I think it really helped my work. I never would have thought of looking at the ceiling if I hadn't had no space. So sometimes, necessity is the mother of invention, and sometimes you can, I don't know. I think it's really helped for me to not know too much. I love art history, but I don't know too much more, really. I always assume that my unconscious will know more my conscious, especially as an artist, because I like to follow my intuition. And I was really worried when I had my show at the Tate whether it was going to look like I was completely jumping around all over the place, because I may work out all kinds of materials and films and drawings and embroidery and boom. But in the end, that was true to me. That's what I needed to do. That's what I felt compelled to do. So if you can get to do that in your lifetime, that's a really good thing.
Thank you very much.
Mm. Thank you for a wonderful talk, and I really appreciate how important the spirit of play is in your work, the way in which subject interacts with medium.
Mm.
And I wanted to raise the photographs that you took on Rudolf Hess's camera, which is displayed in the Penultimate Room of your exhibition.
Yes.
And I wanted to ask what compelled you to create this body of work and why you thought it was appropriate.
Okay, yeah, Rudolf Hess, and he was the commandant of Auschwitz. And I'd done a piece in 1995 with Tilda Swinton, Lion Glass Case, and I curated the installation in which he slept. And I had the camera, I had the host camera, and we were going to put it in the show, but we had a big debate about where we should put it in the show, whether it's too awful what objects have. Did we have any Hitler relics or Nazi relics in the show? So it wasn't in that show. But I still felt quite, it's almost like, is the camera corrupted? So my idea was about photography and cameras, and because this evil man has looked through this camera. I don't think he photographed anything horrible, he just photographed his family with it, I think, but he wasn't a nice man, it was a horrible thing. But I thought, what can I photograph with this camera? So I asked the War Museum if I could take it out in the museum and take a photograph or two for it. And I took photographs of the sky because I thought that was the most benign thing I could take. And I used infrared film. Just gave it that darkness that I wanted. So I think it was called avoided object. You know, so the object being avoided is the camera. But somebody like Lee Miller, whose camera I did have in the show, in the Tilda Swinton show, she photographed Vogue models and also Dachau. She was in Dachau and she photographed all kinds of horrors, really. But did her camera get tainted, you know? I don't know, those are the questions I was asking at the time.
I was just wondering, like, looking at some of your work, there seems to be very interesting impressions of things to you, like the painting like cracks, and then you have the photograph of the negatives at the end, and then the body comes out. And I was just, it's my basic question, but why? Could you maybe elaborate a bit more why you're interested in those things?
I'm interested in negatives for some reason, the same way I'm interested in shadows. Negative spaces are really interesting. And the poppy paper, when I saw it in the factory, I just thought that sums up really about the absence of all the dead, you know, all the people who died in wars. And it's about absence of poppies, not the poppies, but the absence of poppies. So I think sometimes those things I find very powerful. I try and find a way to use them. What was the other one? Sorry, I've forgotten already. I think that is a human condition. You know, sculpture, history of sculpture going back centuries is all about, you know, solids. You know, Henry Moore was very good at solids. And I never felt that way about life. I thought everything's in flux, you know, everything's up and down. You know, and when I find an equivalent in a physical object or a physical, like tarnish, for example, I love tarnish for some reason, but it's about vulnerability of the tarnish. It's about you know, exposure to the atmosphere, you know. And nobody wants a tarnish. Nobody wants a tarnish, especially not famous people. that's why I applauded all those famous people's silverware. There are a number of things which I didn't show you a picture of. But you know, something about the tarnish. So I got this term to put all those objects under, which were called avoided objects, which they were not really objects. They were negatives, or there were things that got lost their identity, you know, from being destroyed or buried or whatever. Why I like someone like Duchamp so much, because he worked on kinds of materials, and he was the first person to cast a negative space, as far as I can tell. The idea of the whole line of artists who made work with negative space. And I was doing, explaining to Bruce Nannon when I was at college, and he'd done casting underneath, the space underneath his hand as he wrote his name. He made it in wax, and it was a piece of stuff. The space under my chair. So monumentalizing something that's very the opposite. So for me, that's why I suspend things, that's why I like shadows, that's why, nature, you know, you look at a tree, the tree is an ephemeral thing, it's got a trunk, but it's leaves and grass and all that stuff in the countryside is very, made up of thousands of little pinpoints. And I was brought up in the countryside, and there was lots of rituals that we did on the small, like scything hay, you know, cutting the grass and raking the hay over, and all that stuff was about process. About ephemerality. And the thing, I remember thinking, we grew vegetables and sold them in a farm shop. And I remember thinking, we spent all this time, planting the seed, watering it, watching it come up, and then you eat it in about 5 minutes. And I just felt very, that's why I became an artist. This is a much more rewarding career than growing vegetables. that might have informed the way I see the world, but I just look what's happened in the last few weeks, you know, that things have been so unstable politically and financially. You know, that's markets, you know, market forces. You know, they're volatile, they're not static things, they're things that can change overnight. So, you know, same with the climate change, you know, that just turned on sixpence. So I think as a human being, it's just, that's the territory I'm looking at, is this kind of relationship with the world that's perhaps a little bit more ephemeral.
Cornelia, terrific as always. This is going to be a slightly tricky question, and I hope I can ask it in a coherent way. It's about where and how meaning enters the work. Because looking at the work, it looks as if it's asking for a big infrastructure of theoretical statements and interpretation. I put dark matter in my nature column. In nature, it transforms it into a commentary on cosmology. And I'm wondering.
I think it's in the eye of the beholder, I think. You know, the work is in the eye of the beholder. I mean, you might see the work as being undercut by theory, but not for me, it's not. What I want from the work is it to be triggers, you know, catalysts. So people might look at it like a piece of music is, you know. Think of a piece of music, you don't think, oh, what's that? What's the theory underpinning that? You know, you listen to it and it transports you, and you get a very personal relationship to the music. And music hasn't got that hang up that art has. I just wish art had the same sort of directness. But I know enough from feedback I've had that people do respond to the work, and even children respond to the work, so that's good. It's always good when kids like it. But you know, they don't worry too much, children. They don't need to unpick meaning. I think meaning comes from the viewer and the object, and the means created, I think, like a catalyst. I don't want the work to have loads of meanings. You know, even the things I can remember and I write down, the real meaning of the work is up to the person who looks at it. So if you're an art historian, you might have a very long. You might have a different view on it than a child.
A better answer than the question.
Down there. I was going to ask, how did you choose what weapon went inside the wood ball?
Sorry?
How did you choose what weapon went inside the wood ball?
Well, I think I just thought about which weapons I had access to. you know, I don't want to kill myself wrapping it up. Well, it's not a gun. That's what I liked about my poison and antidote drawings. I thought, it could possibly kill you. If you ate it, it might poison you. But I don't know if the antidote is going to be as effective. So I don't know. I think the poison might be more effective than the antidote. I like that idea of the antidote. That's why I keep cropping up. And yes, no, these are, my neons. But the idea of having the shadow, painting the neon black. So yes, the no is painted black on top of the neon. I put a neon in the COP26. I made a piece for that, and it was hanging up in the main drag, and it said, "Hurry up, please, it's time." And then I made another sign saying, hurry up. A bit more explicitly, like those on-air light boxes. And this friend of mine is a top economist. She takes it around and sticks it on the table when she has a debate. So I'm operating like this for quite a long time, where I've got a major project on and that's taking some time. But I've usually got a few things on the go that may or may not be artwork, or something that very quickly works, I'm going to make an artwork on Saturday in Cornwall with Vic Green. So I suggest we make a brutalist piece of architecture out of chips and watch the seagulls eat it. That was one. So I don't know. But what I like about him and his humour is it's very improvised. It's just improvised. He went to art school. He gets up every morning at 6 in the morning, paints birds until midday, and then he goes out.
who made this wonderful in Morawowicz, where she sued food cleanings at their friend's aid together, but on one condition, they were given to Chicago Institute that they would never be restored or replaced. So thinking, do you ever think that having these gloves acquired by institutions such as Tate would take all the steps necessary to keep the love as it was received? Does that hinder the ephemeral nature of the love?
Well, I mean, what I do like about my exploded show, for example, that explosion is aging. You know, in 50 years it will be, you know, 80 years old, whatever. You know, I like that. They're asking me if there's any woodwork in any of the wood. And I thought, oh, that'd be quite interesting. Another layer. But I don't know. I think it's, I mean, the large scale works, I very rarely sell one to a private collector because I don't want it to be trashed. I don't want it to end up in an auction. And I don't, you know, it's a bit weird that the older you get, you think, oh, what's going to happen to this? You know, when I never used to worry about what was going to happen to things. I used to make a lot of work that actually just doesn't exist anymore because it was totally ephemeral and it was site specific. And then in the end, the site became part of the work. The work has got the site in it, you know, like the shed. That's, you know, and so the work's still site specific, but it's not as ephemeral as it used to be. Does be quite the right nature of what I've been doing. But I don't think I'm going to make, you know, I don't think I'm going to make kind of big, heavy sculptures. I mean, my first bronzes were those crack pieces, you know, they're pretty ephemeral. The hatchet of bronze. I did a bronze mermaid in Folkestone, as part of the Folkestone Triennale. And it was the body cast of a woman who lived in Folkestone, 38-year-old Margaret II. And she was, you know, sort of not fat, but well endowed. And she wasn't like the mermaid in Coleclough, you know. But it's what I love about the statue, is the bronze sitting on the rock overlooking the sea. It gets used all the time. People put clothes on it while they go swimming, they dress it up at Halloween and Christmas. And it's become a bit of a landmark. That's really nice. It's got its own life, as it were. But I had a thing recently about it, with saying the bronze was deteriorating because of the seawater. Did I want it recast? And I said no. So she will